Hi, this is Chris Monk, owner of Highline Guitars. Sustain. What is it? Why is it so important? And how does a luthier achieve sustain? Well, sustain is pretty easy to understand. It's a word that we use to define the length of time that a string vibrates the instant we pluck it. Why is it important? Well, that's kind of controversial. Some people feel sustain is overrated, but others, like myself, feel sustain is important because it's a way that we judge the quality of an instrument. The longer the guitar sustains, the better the quality of the guitar. So how do we achieve it? Well, the key to sustain, you almost would have to understand in detail how sustain works. And sustain is one of those subjects where as soon as you apply science and physics to it, it starts getting complicated and boring. So I'm going to try to keep it simple. When you pluck the string, it vibrates. That vibration travels out to the ends of the string. And the key to great sustain is to keep that vibration from leaving the string. Now remember, we're talking about solid body electric guitars here. When you're talking about an acoustic guitar, it's very different. In an acoustic guitar, you want that vibration to stimulate or vibrate the surface of the guitar body, because the body acts as an air pump, and when that top vibrates, the air is pumped out, and that's how the sound is amplified. But in a solid body electric guitar, it's very different. The vibration is detected by the magnets in the pickup, and that kind of excites the magnetic field, which causes the electrons in the coil that surround the magnet to start moving, and that's your electrical signal, which gets amplified and then pumped out as sound from your speaker. So ideally what you want is you want to keep that vibration in the string for as long as you possibly can so that it remains detected by the pickup. If the vibration leaves the string, then the sound dies or decays rapidly. So what the luthier needs to do is to try to keep that sustain remaining inside the string. You don't want it to leave it to go into the wood. So the way we do that is we create what could be described as a roadblock at each end. At the body end of the guitar, the roadblock is the bridge. The bridge needs to be made out of a material that is sufficiently dense enough to block that vibration from passing through and into the wood. Instead, it reflects it back into the string, so it remains detectable by the pickups for a longer period of time. So what we look for are high quality bridges that are made from, they can be made from brass, stainless steel, hardened steel, titanium. There are a number of high quality materials that will yield a density sufficient enough to reflect the vibrations back into the string. At the same time, the wood that we use in the body should also be of sufficient density to kick the vibrations back into through the bridge and into the string. Now, some of the vibrations are going to be absorbed and lost. And that's really where the difference between a good guitar or a good sustaining guitar and a poor sustaining guitar come into play. If the bridge is made out of a poor quality material like pop metal, which has a lot of voids in it, it's going to allow the vibrations to pass through it and into the wood. Now, because the wood is so absorbent, it is far less dense than the metal in the bridge, it's going to absorb a lot of those vibrations and dissipate them so that they can't be reflected back into the string where they can be detected by the pickups. So you want a wood that has good density, and the bridge needs to have really good density. Now at the other end, the next most important factor, and is really actually two factors, but I combine them into one, and that is the fret wire and the fretboard. These two elements together, when fabricated properly, will help to reflect that vibration back into the string and keep it from passing on into the wood. Fret wire is made out of either nickel, silver, or stainless steel, and both do an excellent job of reflecting that vibration back into the string. However, because the fret wire is very small in comparison to the bridge, you have the density, but you don't have the mass. So by combining the fret wire with a fretboard of sufficient density, you can get that mass necessary to keep the string from losing its vibration. Of course, this is dependent upon how well the fret is seated into the fretboard. And if it isn't seated well, you create an opportunity for the vibrations to leave the string permanently. So this is one of the reasons why luthiers will choose specific types of material for the fretboard. They'll look at ebony, rosewood, maple, any wood that has sufficient density, because this will achieve two things. First of all, a denser wood does a better job of holding the frets in place, and it also does a better job of reflecting the vibrations back into the string and keeping them there. Then the last element that's of great importance is the nut. The nut needs to be made out of a material of sufficient density as well. Now, when you play the guitar, as you're fretting the string along the fretboard, you're taking that string out of, you're taking the nut out of the picture, because obviously the vibrations aren't getting past the fret and reaching the nut. However, because we do play a lot of open notes in the chords and in some of our soloing, we still have to consider the nut as an important part of the picture, because you don't want to play a chord with an open string and have that one open string have less sustain than the fretted strings. So you need to be conscientious of what the material is in the nut. Now, frequently we use, I would say the three most popular materials are bone, brass, and graphite. Maybe not in that order, but those are the elements, or those are the materials that people seem to use the most. I like to use bone, and I typically use the leg bone of a cow, because leg bones support the weight of the cow and are therefore have greater density. I hear about people using other materials like antler, and in my experience, they just lack the density necessary. You need a good, very dense material to reflect those vibrations back into the string and keep them from dissipating into the wood. So that's kind of what I look for when I make the nut. And so really what it comes down to overall in achieving great sustain in a guitar is density. Another kind of funny observation that I've made over the years is I like to use flame maple in my fretboards because I like the way it looks. But I've discovered that, you know, with flame maple, you have two kinds of grain on the surface. You've got face grain, and then you've got end grain. The face grain is harder, the end grain is softer. And wherever you've got frets installed into the face or the harder grain, you get great sustain because there's a greater density in that area, which is kicking the vibrations back into the string. But where the fret is installed into the end grain, which is softer, it has a tendency to absorb those vibrations and remove them from the string. So on a flame maple fretboard, I would find that, you know, maybe every other fret would have excellent sustain, whereas the others lacked sustain. So I still like to use flame maple because I like the way it looks. I just know going into it that there's probably going to be some subtle issues with sustain. And if sustain is hypercritical to you as a guitar player, avoid flame maple. But if you're like a lot of guitar players who play so quickly up and down the fretboard that you're kind of mowing down the previous note's sustain, then it's really not going to be an issue. So, but that's kind of how I look at sustain and the way I achieve it in my guitars. And I hope that makes sense. So now I'm going to get back to work and finish intonating this guitar.